is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, water you turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, there's none like you. Darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, there's none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Come, they told me about Abba. Bum, bum.
Hey, good morning. You may be seated. Hey, it's good to see you guys this morning. And wow, kind of gloomy weather today, yeah? A little bit gloomy, yeah. Kind of went out, a little bit rainy. I didn't even know it was supposed to rain today, so yeah, it's a good day. All right, good day. So it's good to see you guys today. We're going to go before the Lord in prayer, ask God's blessing as we receive the offering this morning. And then Bill will come and give us some announcements of what's going on in the church. John Bortz, would you lead us in prayer, please?
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you again that we could come into your house. It's a beautiful morning. It was grizzly out there, but still a beautiful morning to be in your house. A beautiful morning to come into your vision. Give you glory, Jesus. We thank you for this time of year as we celebrate the birth of Jesus, the Lord and Savior. We just thank you for his willingness to come out here to serve, to teach, to lead.
Amen. And let me say, if this is your first time here at Lighthouse, let me say welcome. We're glad that you are here, and we hope and pray that you hear from God today. Bill, why don't you come give us some announcements?
Good morning. I love Christmas songs, particularly the part about where we don't have a gift deserving of Him. And last night we were, I don't remember exactly where we were, but there was a sign in front of a church that said, "Our Father gave us a gift. He hung it on the cross." That's... let's see. Back to where we were doing here. Okay, everybody that partnered with a child for KVC, today is the deadline. Get with Miss Dina, wherever she is. In class. Okay. After class, get with Miss Dina. Christmas party. 17th, 5 o'clock, right here. Everybody has to buy a white elephant and bring it. So, hope we can get one for $5. Okay, Wednesday the 21st and 28th, there'll be no Bible study. Candlelight service, Christmas Eve. Great time to be here. Great program. 6 o'clock, right here. And then Sunday, right back here. Christmas Day. Also on Christmas Day, the children will have a party back there. Please, what do we have? Snacks. Make sure we have snacks, 15 per class. Any questions? Talk to Christine Johnson on that one. Also, next week, Christmas offering. Trying to pay down the building so that we can do exactly what that wall says back there. Go out into all the world and preach the gospel, that we can pick up other ministries too. And let's see, youth groups, 18th also, go caroling. Wow, we don't get to carol. Anyway, first off, if you're a guest, welcome. Please pull off the little perforation, fill it out, drop it in the boxes back there. I hear the pastor will stop by and bring you a pie of your choice. Also, I guess we don't have to worry about Wednesday night because it's not going to happen, right? Oh, this Wednesday night. I'm ahead of myself here. Okay, Wednesday night. If you're going to be here, please fill out the other half of the perforated strip and drop it in the box so that we can get a good head count. Thank you.
Would you all stand to worship with us again, please? Jesus' name.
the storm. He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the same. Trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found. Rest in his righteousness alone. Call us to stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone. Savior's love through the storm. He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all.
thank you for this time we can come together and worship you this morning. And please let us raise our voices to you and sing your praises. And please help worship have prepared hearts this morning to hear what Tim has to say as he comes forth and brings your word this morning, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Amen. Wow, I love that song. New song for our church. Yes. A greeters meeting right after church today. We had asked that we forgot, didn't get it in the bulletin, or is in the bulletin. And so if you're a greeter, if you could meet right over here right after church today, Sharon would like to meet with you guys. Is it ushers? It's not greeters? It's ushers. Okay. Greeters and ushers are meeting today right after church. The greeters will be on my left and the ushers will be on my right. Okay? All right. All right. Also, I just want to say a big thanks to Autumn Johannes, Lisa Workman, and Emily Eggleston for decorating our church. They did an outstanding job. So, from the foyer all the way in, and they've just done a fantastic job. So, thank you, ladies, for doing that. All right. If you have your Bibles today, I'm going to invite you to Romans chapter number 5 this morning. Romans. We're actually going to start in Romans 3. We're actually going to stay in the book of Romans this morning. And I hope you have a Bible. If you don't, you really need to grab one. And there should be some around you in a seat back. I want to say this, and I say this not trying to be mean or anything like that, so don't take it that way. But our mission as our church, the first thing we're about in our mission is about discipleship. It's about learning. And this here, to me, on Sunday mornings is discipleship. I am discipling you as followers of Jesus Christ and as not followers of, non-followers of Jesus Christ. I'm also discipling, and so bringing your Bible to church is like so important, and I'll tell you why. It's the same thing as if you were going to history class at school and you didn't bring your history book, right? Because you're going to be reading out of the history book, and history, you're going to want to know what you're learning because you want to see it on paper. Now, I'm sorry, unless you have a kid's Bible, there are no pictures in here. So that's, you know, I know that's tough. If you go into the back where the maps are, there's pictures back there, and you can kind of stroll back there a little bit. Not right now, though. But bring your Bibles because it's so important that you grasp and get a hold of what I'm teaching every Sunday, every Wednesday, and because this is good for you. I'm going to bring something I've never preached this before. Matter of fact, for a Christmas season, I kept going, you know, how do you tell the Christmas story over and over and over in a new way, you know? Next Sunday, I've got a special sermon picked out for next Sunday that I'm going to do, but for this one, it's still a Christmas message, but it's probably a little bit different than most of you are maybe even used to. And actually, what I want to do is just to begin is talk about the best gift ever. How many of you ever had a best gift ever? Anybody ever have a best gift ever? Okay. Now, I know some of you would probably say, my children are my best gift ever. The only problem I have with that is children do not come with a receipt. And so they, just kidding, just kidding. Best gift ever. I'll tell you what, I remember when I was a little kid, I can't remember how old I was. I think it was like nine, maybe eight or nine, I don't know. But the best gift I ever had was a pump action BB gun. It was black, it had the pump action right here on the muzzle. And when I got that thing, it was the coolest thing. I felt so grown up. I felt like an adult. And I remember because it also shot pellets in it as well. And it had this little thing you push right here where the trigger is. You push it down and you fill it full of BBs. And then you sit there and you pump it up. And the more you pump it, the farther it'll go. And more velocity. And man, we'd shoot frogs and we'd shoot snakes. We used to go moccasin hunting in Florida, where I'm from, and we'd go down to the creeks and we'd shoot moccasins and not the things you wear, but the things that slither. And we'd shoot birds and but it was fun as a kid. And then when we went camping, because when I was a kid, you could go camping and it was cool, you were safe. And we'd go out and we'd hide in the orange groves and we'd shoot cars as they came by. And it was fun until they screeched to a halt. And of course, then we'd start running. And it was just a good time. And I took such good care of that gun. I remember rubbing it down with some oil. My stepdad, who gave me the gun, gave me some oil. I don't know, was 2-in-1 oil or 4-in-1 oil or whatever kind of oil it was, but he showed me how to rub it down. And man, I'd rub that BB gun down. It always stayed right in the corner of my room, right next to my bed. And whenever I carried it, you know, I'd carry it like a big old hunter, you know, I'd point down or I'd point it straight up, you know, and I'd be all macho and everything with my BB gun. And man, I just loved it. Took really good care of it. And it was the best gift ever. But I'll tell you what happened. As I got older, it kind of lost interest. It kind of sat in the corner more often, and then it moved from the corner to my closet. I didn't oil it down much anymore, and it ended up starting getting rusted. I didn't shoot it as often through time, and I kind of lost interest in it. But it wasn't until I was 23 that I got actually the best gift ever. I received this best gift ever, and I've never lost interest in it. As a matter of fact, the older I've gotten from this gift that I got when I was 23, the sweeter it is, the better it is, the more attracted I am to it, the more time I spend with it. And of course, you guys already know I'm going to talk about Jesus. He is the greatest gift of all, and he is the best gift ever. The Apostle Paul said it right when he said this. In 2 Corinthians 9:15, he said, "Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift." And Jesus truly is indescribable. Amen, Christians? He truly is indescribable. Now, I'm sure most of you know the gift is, of course, Jesus. And he wasn't just given to me. You know, I'm not somebody actually super special, but he was given to all of us. And he is the best gift ever. But here's the thing. Most people will never grasp that he's the best gift ever until you understand and grasp why he's the best gift ever. Because even as Christians, as followers of Christ, we may not even grasp and understand that Jesus is the best gift ever or the greatest gift of all. We as Christians may sometimes miss that as well. Now, do you know why he's the best gift ever given? Here's why. And what, I'm going to talk about one word this morning. And it's a word that you may have never heard of. It's a word that may be new to you. And it may be a word that's so old to you, you have forgotten all about it. And here's the word. You ready? Justification. Justification. Now, he is the best gift ever given because of justification. I know many of you are going, now wait a minute. That just like justification, what in the world does that mean? Well, let me give you the definition of justification, and I promise you through Scripture this morning, we're going to learn exactly why that is so important that you and I understand what that is. And when you do, when you grasp the understanding of justification, you're going to grasp that Jesus truly is the best gift ever given. Justification, this is the definition. Pronounced, someone who is pronounced or treated as righteous. Let me say that again. Justification is someone who is pronounced or treated as righteous. Now, here's the thing. Does it really matter that you and I are pronounced righteous at all? Well, very much so, as a matter of fact, because here's the thing. The only way you can gain entrance into heaven is by being righteous. Are you with me? The only way you can go to heaven is by being righteous. Why? Because God is righteous. And in heaven there is no sin. You must be righteous to enter the kingdom of heaven. And what does it mean to be righteous? Well, one Bible scholar translates it this way. He says, the Bible's standard of human righteousness is God's own perfection in attribute, every attitude, every behavior, and every word. Let me say that again. Righteousness, our righteousness, must meet God's perfection in every attribute, every attitude, every behavior, and every word. Now the question remains is, are you righteous? Have you met God's perfection in every attribute, every attitude, every behavior, and every word? Because listen, the only way you can go to heaven is to be righteous, which is to be the same thing as being justified by God. So you say, well, I may not be perfect, but I'm good, or I'm righteous in a lot of ways. You may say, well, I don't steal. I don't lie. I'm good to people, right? How many would maybe not would say that? Okay. but we all have our own self-righteousness that we look at our lives and go, well, I'm not as bad as that person or that person or that person or that person, especially as that person. No, I'm just kidding. They weren't looking. So I'm just teasing. But we have our own self-righteousness. But here's the thing. Our own righteousness is not good enough. Our own righteousness is never good enough. And here's why. Isaiah 64. Isaiah the prophet said, but we are all like an unclean thing, and our righteousnesses are like filthy rags. We all fade as a leaf, and our iniquities, the word iniquities means sin. It means iniquity is when we sin willfully. Iniquities, like the wind, have taken us away. You see, our own self-righteousness is as filthy rags, the prophet Isaiah said. Matter of fact, Paul even said in Romans 3:10, as it is written, there is none righteous. No, not one. You go, now, wait a minute. If Jesus is the best gift ever given, and I've got to be righteous to get into heaven, and yet the Bible says there is none righteous, no, not one, how does this work then? How am I supposed to attain righteousness so that I can go to heaven? Let me say this again. You will never enter heaven on account of your own righteousness, because none of us are righteous. Every one of us are sinners. Here's the thing. We're all born that way. I've said this several times before, and I won't go into that again, but we're all born that way. You don't sin and become a sinner. You sin because you are a sinner. Okay? You don't sin and then become, it's not like you're, 12, 13, 16 years old, and for the first time in your life, you commit a sin. You go, oh, now I'm a sinner. I became a sinner. No. You were born that way. You don't sin and become a sinner. You sin because you are a sinner. You see what I'm saying? So we're like doomed from the beginning. Doomed from the beginning. So what has to happen in order for us to enter heaven? Well, we've got to be made righteous. We've got to be made righteous in order to have it. And how is that done? There goes this one word. I want you to keep this. We're going to see a lot. And that is justification. Justification. Okay? Remember, justification is pronounced or treated as righteous. Now, how do you and I get pronounced or treated as righteous? Here's the thing. It's by receiving the greatest gift ever, and that is Jesus. Romans chapter number 3. Now, follow along with me because we're going to turn to a ton of scripture here in Romans. We'll be right here in Romans. I won't go anywhere else. I've got scripture on the wall, but I don't have all this that we're going to look at in Romans on the wall, so please grab a Bible. You're going to want to see this. This is really, really, really good, okay? Now, verse number 21, we've got to receive the greatest gift ever given, who is Jesus. That is the only way you can be pronounced or treated as righteous. Verse 21, but now the righteousness of God apart from the law, is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through what? Faith in Jesus Christ. The righteousness of God comes upon us through faith in his Son, Jesus Christ. Now notice what he says. Through faith in Jesus Christ to all and what? What's the next two words? What is it? On all. All the people on the left got it. In the center and right, you catch up here. The righteousness of God through faith in Christ to all and on all who what? What's the next word, church? Believe. Faith. Faith in, believe in Jesus Christ. It's not a head knowledge, it's a heart knowledge. Paul says, put your faith in Christ. When you put your faith in the Lord, you believe in him, you receive the righteousness of God, or Christ's righteousness. Notice what he says, for there is no difference. Now just let that sink in for just a second. Paul is saying that God's righteousness is placed on all who believe in Jesus Christ. And what are the last words? For there is no difference. In other words, it doesn't matter who you are, where you were born, where you come from, where you're going, where you're at, how old you are, young you are, how you look. All of that stuff. Listen, it doesn't matter. Are you with me? It doesn't matter, because God's righteousness will be placed on you through faith in his Son Christ upon anyone who, what? Believes. Believes. Notice what he says. Verse 23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Here's the thing. You will never, ever, 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 and a zillion evers after that, enter the kingdom of heaven on your own righteousness. You must be declared righteous by God himself. And the only way God declares you righteous is when by faith you receive his Son as your Savior. Why? Why do you need a Savior? Verse 23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I wish you would have said, and fallen way short of the glory of God, because I'm wondering, some people go, well, I'm almost there. I'm almost got God's glory. No, you weren't even close. None of us were. And see, this, what I'm hoping this morning, matter of fact, last night, I'm reading this and going through these different chapters, and it's like, I know this is going to sound weird, and I don't mean to sound unspiritual, but there are times in God's Word, and those of you that have been following Jesus for a long time will know what I'm saying. There are times when God shows you things in his Word as you read that just come afresh to you. Last night, I'm crying. I'm about to, the tears are about falling, because God opens my heart about justification. And it begins to show me in these verses of, think about that, Tim. This was free. It didn't cost you anything. God, this is good. Where's it at? Romans 8. This just came to mind. I don't want to get off track here. Romans 8:28. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose, for whom God foreknew us. He also chose us, to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. Whom he called, he also... There's that word again, justified. God made me righteous, even though I'm not. God declared me righteous the moment I received faith, at the moment I received Christ by faith at the age of 23. God declared me, boom, Tim, you're righteous. You can come to heaven. But God, I don't deserve it. I say you're righteous. Through faith in my son, because of your belief in my son, you are now clothed in his righteousness. That means every time God sees me, he sees righteousness. Notice what he says. He justified these, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Let's go back to our text, but back to Romans, I'm sorry. I just wanted to read that. It's God gave this freely to us, justification. Now, what you've got to do is, whether you're a good moral person or you're not, whether you grew up in a Christian home and, you know, you never smoked, drank, and chewed, and never hung around those who do, and or however that wording goes, and you never dated a girl that dipped snuff or whatever, and I couldn't do that either. But if you grew up in a Christian home and nothing, you never did bad stuff, you've got to understand your condition meets the same criteria as my condition, and I was one, just like many of you here this morning, that was lost. You were in pornography, drugs, alcohol. You were in the filth of the filth of the filth. And many of you, if I was to ask you to raise your hands, give a testimony, there's a lot of you here that could say, I was there. Listen, your condition as a moral person raised in a Christian home was the same condition as my condition as a rotten, dirty, gutter-laying sinner. My point is every single one of us are sinners in the eyes of God. Are you with me? And here's the thing. If you can grasp this morning that Jesus is the greatest gift of all, because here's the thing. Despite our sin, our filthiness, our rebellion, everything that we are, God in his love, in his great love for us, chose us, saved us by our faith in Christ, and declared us righteous. We don't deserve it. We don't deserve it. Nobody deserves God's righteousness. And yet, God declares us righteous. Now to me, as I began to meditate and chew on that, my eyes started watering and I'm beginning to cry, saying, God, this is a new, fresh thing of showing me that You declared me righteous even though I don't even deserve it. I don't even see myself that way. And yet God does. Notice what he says, Romans 3:24, being justified freely, say freely. Does that cost anything? Is free stuff cost anything? It's free, right? Being justified freely by his, and here's the key word, by what? Grace, God's grace. Grace that will pardon and cleanse within. The other song, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Amazing, isn't it? Grace. Freely justified by his grace through the redemption that is in what? His Son, Jesus Christ. Whom God set forth as a propitiation or sacrifice by his blood through faith, to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance God had passed over the sins that were previously committed, to demonstrate at the present time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Who is it that justifies us and makes us right in his eyes? Who? God makes us right and... Listen, verse number 26. To demonstrate at the present time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. God is the one who justifies us freely by his grace through his Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus is the best gift ever. Why? Because he's done more for you than anything could ever happen to you in your life. He has done something for you you could never do yourself, nor could anyone else do for you, but he has done something for you if you receive him by faith that is miraculous. It's awesome. It's unbelievable. It's indescribable. It's crazy. And it's true. Through Christ, we have been justified, made righteous. Now, as a side note, we would think, or some may think, well, if I'm made righteous, that's what God was giving me last night. If I'm made righteous, that means that no matter what I do, I am in righteous in God's eyes. Yes, that is true. But on the same hand, God like spoke to me and was saying, because I have declared you righteous, live righteously. Don't take what I've given so freely to you and squander it. Don't live your life for yourself, but live it for me, God says. Because I have freely given to you what you never had before. And I did it because I love you. I did it because I care about you. I love you. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For God made Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become what? The righteousness of God in him. Jesus took on our sin at the cross when he died 2,000 years ago. You know the story. When Jesus was nailed to the cross and he cries out, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? My God, why have you forsaken me? God turned his back on his son because it was then that Jesus took upon him the sins of the world. And when he did, he took on your sin. He took on my sin. And he did this all freely so that we could be righteous. God could declare us righteous. Turn over to Romans 4. Romans 4:22. In Romans 4, Paul is talking about the righteousness of Abraham and how God declared him righteous through his faith. And notice what he says in verse 22, and therefore it was accounted to him, counted to Abraham. If you read all of chapter 4, there's a lot to read there, but read that on your time. He says, and therefore it was accounted to him for righteousness. Now it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but also for us. It shall be imputed to us who believe in him who raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was delivered up because of our offenses and was raised because of our, yes, because of our justification. What does that word imputed mean? Imputed means to ascribe to someone by virtue of a similar quality in another. God imputed on us the righteousness of Christ because of our faith in him. Amen, preacher. That's awesome. Yes. God imputed on us the righteousness of Christ. He was delivered up, verse 25, because of our offenses, not because of his own, because he was sinless, and was raised because of our justification. Verse number 1 of chapter 5, you're right there. Therefore, because he said all of that, he said, having been justified by faith, we have what? Peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, if you think you had peace with God outside of Jesus, you have been totally mistaken, my friend. I was mistaken growing up all my life. I thought I knew, of course, you know, recognize in a mental capacity who God is. I knew that he created the worlds. And in a mental capacity, I understood God, or I thought I did. And in my mental capacity, I knew who Jesus was. I knew he was God's son. I knew he went to a cross and died for the sins of the world. And I knew this mentally, but I never put it here in my heart. I never acted out by simple faith and received Jesus to myself. In my mind, I thought God and I were like this. The whole time I'm doing drugs and all this stuff, I wasn't hurting anybody. I wasn't a murderer. You know, we always say, I never killed anybody. Like, that's supposed to separate us from the good people from the bad people. As long as you don't kill anybody, right? Then you're okay. And yet we got it all wrong, because just lying is the same as killing somebody. But in my mind, growing up, I thought God and I were like this. And I thought, well, God knows me. I know God. He understands me. I understand him. I'm in. Oh, how wrong I was. I wasn't at peace with God. I wanted to say I was, but I wasn't, because the only way you can be at peace with God is through Jesus Christ. That's it. That's what the Word says, right? This isn't Timology. This is Bible. Are you with me? And so he says, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only that, let me skip all that, because here he talks about, the only reason why, it's a lot of reading, he's talking about tribulations and how they help, they produce, perseverance and character and hope and all of that stuff. So skip down to verse 6. For when we were still without strength, in other words, we do not have the strength to meet the righteousness of God, we don't have the strength to make it to heaven on our own. For when we were still without strength, in due time Christ died for the, notice what he calls us. Who's ungodly? Say, I am. Now I know some of you are like, I'm not ungodly. I know. Listen, I know. It's hard to, as good moral people, it's hard to look at yourself and go, I'm ungodly. But the truth of the matter is, we all are. We all are in the eyes. We're all sinners, and we need help, and we got to have the righteousness of Christ in order to enter the kingdom of heaven. We must be justified by God, and the only way that happens is through faith. He says, for when we were still without strength, in due time Christ died for us, the ungodly. That's us. First, notice what he says. I love this. For scarcely for a righteous man one will die, or will one die, excuse me, yet perhaps for a good man, someone would even dare to die. Now, he kind of gives an illustration there. It's like some of us here, we would go, well, you know, there's some people I'd probably give my life for. You know, there's some pretty good righteous people, or that I would say righteous or good people. I might give my life for them. But would you give your life for not a righteous person? Would you give your life for an immoral person? Would you give your life for a wicked, ungodly person? And the answer is no, you wouldn't. Please don't anybody go, now, Pastor, I would. I'd give my life. No, you wouldn't. No, you wouldn't. Don't be super spiritual. Don't be so oversaved that you just like, I call people like that oversaved. So I'd give my life for anybody. No, I don't think you would. Here's the thing. Jesus is the only one that gave his life for every wicked, ungodly, sinful person in this world. And that was Jesus Christ. And he gave his life for us. Notice verse 8. But God demonstrates his own love toward us. He proved his love toward us in that while we were still sinners, we never go, okay, God, I'm going to clean up my life. God, I'm going to clean up my life and come to you. God, I'm going to get rid of all this unrighteousness, ungodliness. I'm going to get rid of it all. And God, I'm going to come to you. No, that's not the way it works. It never works that way. But he said, but God demonstrated his love, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than having now been justified by his blood. There's that word again, justified, declared righteous. By who? Jesus, his blood, his sacrifice. We shall be saved from wrath through him, the wrath of God. Listen, you don't think the wrath of God is coming? Listen, I know this isn't, this, you don't hear this type of preaching everywhere, and I know that. But the wrath of God is coming. You don't think that this earth is going to be judged. You don't think that we're going to be judged as America, as a world. It's coming. As a matter of fact, last Wednesday night, I talked about the signs of the times and how in Jerusalem, in Israel right now, they are gathering offerings right now to build the temple. The temple that's prophesied that's going to come. The temple where the Antichrist is going to step inside and sign a peace treaty. The temple where this Antichrist is going to set up the abomination of desolation. The Jews already in Jerusalem have the menorah built. It's gold, made out of gold. They already have the table of incense made out of gold. They already have the garments of the priests. They already have the altar of the incense bowls. They already have the table of showbread all in gold. They've already got all the stuff. It's all encased in glass. And they have commercials that run all the time that are asking for donations so they can get the next temple built. And my friend, listen, when that temple, when that first shovel hits the ground and breaks that dirt, you better believe that God's wrath is coming soon, because that's all prophesied that this is going to happen. And when it does, 7 years of tribulation are going to hit. If you want to know what it's going to be like, just read the book of Revelations, okay? Read the book of Revelations. Now, I'm going to say all that to really scare you. Well, maybe, but I've heard some old preacher go, I was scared into heaven, you know. I don't want to go to hell either, you know. So the obvious, you know, receive Christ, you know. But here's the thing, God's wrath is coming. And I know that's not popular preaching, because we don't want to hear things and we don't want to talk about things like that, because we don't want to lose people and we don't, you know, you don't want to, like, you know, make people mad or anything. But the truth is, Paul talked about it. Jesus talked about it in Matthew 24 and 25. And he talked about the wrath of God, and you all, and even in the book of Revelations, it's coming. I don't know when. I'm not going to say it's, you know, next week or next year or 10. I don't know when, but I just know that Word of God tells us that the wrath of God will come, and that we through Christ are saved from that wrath. I believe this more than I believe you. Call it narrow mind, whatever, but I just do. I believe this cover to cover. Even the maps. No, I'm just kidding. So let's move on. Where was I? Okay, because I got to go. Demonstrates, okay, much more than, we shall be, verse 9, justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath through him. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled. Oh, this is good stuff. I got to come down. For when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son. Much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his what? His life. Salvation. What is it? I've got it up here. Now. It'll be up here in a little bit. Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Yes, salvation is a gift. And we're reconciled to God. Reconciliation simply means when two people are fighting, let's say Larry and Debbie are at it again. Just kidding. They're an awesome couple. And but let's just say they're fighting and Debbie goes, Pastor, you need to come over and talk. Larry's just gone crazy. And so I come over and I talk to the both of them and I say, now, come on, Larry. Now, you know, treat your wife right, you know, and all this and that. And I take them by the hands and I join their two hands together. And I'll say, now you say you're sorry and you say you're sorry. Let's, you know, and kiss and make up. And then you turn your head. Yeah. But anyways, but that's what reconciliation is, bringing two people back together who were at odds with one another. We're at odds with God. You say, I'm not at odds with God. Listen, because you are a sinner, listen, you can't enter the kingdom of heaven unless you have the righteousness of Christ. So here's the thing. Jesus was our reconciler. That's why he said in John 14, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through me. 2 Corinthians 5, where he says, he has given unto us the ministry of reconciliation, because we've been reconciled to God. So Jesus took God's hand in our hand. He says, here you go. And you got to go through Jesus to do that. Are you with me? Verse number 12, I love what he does here. So I'm almost done. I got so much to tell you. He says, therefore, just as through one man's sin entered the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men because all sin. He's talking about Adam. When Adam and Eve sinned, You say, it's not my fault that they sinned. Listen, I don't like it any more than you do, but it is what it is. And he said, because Adam's sin entered into the world, and now death has reigned from mankind all the way down through man's seed. Everyone dies. Every single one of us. We die twice. We die once spiritually, and we die physically. Okay? God said that's what's going to happen if you eat of the tree, the garden of good and evil. It's going to happen. So through Adam, all have sinned. Verse 13, for until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those who had not sinned according to the likeness of the transgression of Adam, who is a type of him who was to come. But the free gift, say free gift, is not like the offense. For if by the one man's offense many died, here it is, much more the grace of God and the gift, say the gift, by the grace of the one man, capitalized, Jesus Christ, abounded to who? The select few. The good people. The moral people. No. What did we already learn? Jesus died for all. Right? His righteousness is, God gives his righteousness to all and on all who believe, right? Verse 16, and the gift is not like that which came through the one who sinned, for the judgment which came from one offense resulted in condemnation, that sin that's been passed down, but the free gift, say free gift, which came from many offenses resulted in what? Yes. Is this gift cost you anything? Is it free? For if by one man's offense death reigned through one, much more those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift, say the gift, of righteousness will reign in life through the one Jesus Christ. Therefore, as though one man's offense judgment came to all men, that's Adam and the sin coming down, resulting in condemnation, even so through one man's righteous act, the free gift came to all men, resulting in justification of life. Verse 19, for as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience many will be made what, church? Righteous. Through one man's sin, Adam, his disobedience made us all sinners. But through the obedience of Christ, we are all made righteous. Wasn't Paul right when he said, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift? Jesus truly is the greatest gift ever. For sake of time, I'm going to just give you two things real fast and I've got to close. There are two things about justification I want you to remember. You ready? You can close your Bibles. I'll have these on the screen. There are two things about justification I want you to remember. And that is, justification is never earned, but only given. Stop trying to earn your way into heaven. Believe on Christ and you will be saved. Titus 3 says, but when the kindness and the love of God, our Savior toward man, appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done. Why? Because our righteousness, as Isaiah said, are as filthy rags. But according to his mercy, he saved us through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior, that having been justified by his grace, justified by God, his grace, his mercy, he chooses to declare us righteous, even though we don't deserve it. We should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Romans 6, 23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Stop trying to get to heaven on your own accord. You will never ever make it. No matter how good you think you are, how righteous you think you are, stop. Stop. Receive Christ. Receive Him as your Savior. Call upon Him, the Bible says, while He is near. And secondly, justification is always given. But I want you to know that justification is not cheap, but very costly. Justification came at the cost of Jesus giving His life for us. 1 Peter, for Christ also what? What did He do? He suffered, guys. I want you to grasp that. Jesus suffered so that we could be declared righteous. Justification isn't cheap. In other words, and I'm not saying that it costs you anything, because it doesn't. It's not cheap, but it's very costly. Why? Because Jesus suffered. He suffered once for sins. The just for the unjust. The just for the unjust. That He might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit. Remember, He took our sins upon Himself so that we could become justified. Don't treat His salvation as something cheap. I'm going to close with 2 Corinthians 1 and 2. Paul said this. We then as workers, I'm sorry, that's 2 Corinthians 6. I forgot to put the 6 in there. We then as workers together with Him also plead with you not to receive the grace of God in vain. What is the grace of God? Jesus. For He says, in an acceptable time I have heard you, and in the day of salvation I have helped you. Did God hear you when you cried out to Him and asked for salvation? Did He hear you? Did He help you? Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me, for me?